Well, it is a great privilege to have Lee Strobel, an author, writer, former pastor, a man that God has touched his life, and he tells his story. And we have the privilege of having him here, and we've had two great services, and it is our privilege to have him here again. So why don't you give the best welcome out of the three services from Friends Church to Lee Strobel, all right?
Thanks, Matthew. Yeah.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thanks so much. It's just been a privilege to be here this weekend. What a great church, and getting to know the staff and a lot of volunteers and tenders and folks who've come just out of curiosity today. I'm just thrilled with that. It's great to be back in Southern California. I lived here for about 10 years. About 4 months ago, I moved to Denver. And so sorry about that game on Friday night with the Lakers and the Nuggets. And I'm a Nuggets fan now. I don't care. This is great. I loved it. I thought it was a great game. But I live out there, and a lot of my friends out in California did not understand. What do you mean you're going to move to Colorado? They didn't get it. I mean, because they don't understand the concept of winter. I mean, they grew up out here. There is no winter, right? And they don't get it. One guy said to me, I could never live in Colorado. I said, why not? He said, because I could never live in a place where if I accidentally lock myself out of the house, I could die. makes some sense, you know. The one negative about living there, and there's no kidding, they gave me a phone number, right? New phone number. It's one digit away from the local marijuana dispensary. Seriously, I get about half a dozen calls a day, and they're all alike. I go, hello, and the other voice says, hey, man. Which, when I was in Chicago, I was actually one digit away on my phone number from the cab company, which was really a problem, because about 2 in the morning on Saturday night, you get the call from all the drunk people saying, hey, I need a ride, you know. And so it was bad enough getting awakened at 2 in the morning, but then you got to get dressed, get in the car, you know, go pick them up. But anyway, one thing I appreciate, Matthew said, you know, you can talk about whatever you want, and I love to talk about why it is that we as Christians believe what we believe. Is there any credibility? Is there a rationality behind the Christian faith? And I'll talk to one person about that, or 500, 5,000, doesn't matter, because I think it's important stuff, and I think it's interesting stuff. But I will admit to you, there are times when I get into one of these conversations, it does not go well. I don't know if you ever had that happen, but I had the most embarrassing thing happen a few years ago. I was down south at a conference with my buddy Mark Middleberg, who many of you met here last weekend. And afterwards, the next day, we're going to fly out, so we're going to get some breakfast. And we saw one of these Cracker Barrel places. You ever see one of these things? I'd never been to one, but it looked okay. So we're going to go there. We noticed they had rocking chairs on the front porch. And in the first rocking chair was a young woman, about 18 years old, dark hair, dark eyes, quite attractive. Young man sitting next to her, about the same age. So we had to walk in front of them to get to the door. Well, big deal, right? So we're walking along, and just as I step in front of this young woman, I hear her say, "What's a deist?" And I thought, I just wrote a book about that. So I turned on my heel, and I looked her in the eye, and I said, "A deist is someone who believes that God created the universe, but then he walked away." I said, a deist is someone who believes that God sort of wound up the universe like a giant clock and is just letting it tick down. I said, a deist is someone who believes that God is distant and detached and disinterested. But I said, that's not what the evidence shows. And I began to talk about all the evidence that shows God's involvement in the cosmos, God's involvement in humankind. I started giving all this facts, all this data, all this information. I talked about cosmology. I talked about physics. I talked about biochemistry. I talked about human genetics. I'm going on and on, giving on. Their eyes are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'm on a roll. You can't stop me. And I talk about Jesus entering into human history. I talk about his death on the cross, about the evidence for the resurrection. Her eyes are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And I'm going on and on. Finally, I turned to Mark. I said, can you believe it? I happened to walk in front of her. She said, what's a deist? Mark said, Lee. She said, Buenos dias. You know, I really wish that were a joke. That's what happened. It was so embarrassing. So I thought, okay, well, how can I talk to you all today about the evidence for the Christian faith? What can I do? And I thought, well, you know what? I'm going to do something real simple. I'm just going to tell you a story. It's a true story. It's my story. And it's a story that began in atheism. Because I concluded at a young age, as a teenager, that there is no God. the idea, the concept of God is absurd. That God didn't create people, but people created God. Why? Because they were afraid of death, and so they manufactured this idea of this benevolent jelly bean in the sky and this idea of heaven to make themselves feel better when they die. That's what I thought. I thought that the mere concept of an all-powerful, all-loving, all-knowing creator of the universe was just absurd on the surface of it. Was not even worth my time to check out. Now, granted, I tend to be a skeptical person. I mean, that's in my DNA. My background's in journalism and law. You can imagine, you put those two things together, kind of a jerk, a skeptic, that you get. I was a legal editor of the Chicago Tribune newspaper. And we used to pride ourselves on our skepticism. We never would accept anybody's word at face value. We always wanted to get two sources to confirm a fact before we'd print it in the newspaper. So we actually had a sign in our newsroom that said, "If your mother says she loves you, check it out." How do you know? Maybe she's lying. You got any proof? Got any data? Got any evidence? I mean, that's, you know, the kind of the perspective we had. And it spilled over into my spiritual perspective. Now, because I had no belief in God, I really had no universal, overarching moral framework for my life. I just, you know, sort of made up my morality as I went. My number one value was to bring maximum pleasure into my life. It was to keep myself happy at all costs. And this is embarrassing to talk about, but I came to tell you the truth. I lived a very immoral, drunken, profane, narcissistic, self-absorbed, self-destructive, in many ways, kind of a life. And that's who I was. Had a lot of anger inside of me, a lot of rage inside of me. If you asked me back then, why are you so mad? I don't think I could have told you, but looking back, I know what it was. I was always after the perfect high. I was always after that ultimate experience of pleasure. And in the end, everything disappointed. You always let down. Nothing lived up to the hype. And so I just remember being angry. I remember one day, my wife and I got in an argument. Our little daughter was there. And I just lost. I was so enraged. I remember I reared back and boom, I kicked a hole right through our living room wall. And they're crying. And I said, that's who I was. In fact, I'm going to tell you the ugliest thing about me, which is when my little girl, Allison, was just a little toddler. If she was alone in the living room, you know, playing with some blocks or some toys or something, and she would hear me come home from work through the front door, her natural reaction was just to gather her toys and go in her room and close the door. She can be drunk again. She could be yelling and screaming and kicking holes in the wall. You know what? At least it's nice and quiet in here. Friends, that is the ugliest truth about me. My wife was agnostic. And one day we moved into a new condominium building in suburban Chicago, and the woman downstairs was a Christian. Her name was Linda. And she had a daughter the same age as Allison. And Linda became best friends with my wife, Leslie. And it was very natural in the course of their friendship for Linda to talk about Jesus to Leslie, because Linda was a Christian and Jesus was a big part of her life. And Leslie was interested. Nobody ever talked to her about this stuff before. She was fascinated. And she went to church with her, kind of checked things out, investigated. Finally, she came up to me one day, many months later, and said, "Lee, I made a big decision." I said, "What?" She said, "I've decided to become a follower of Jesus Christ." And I thought, oh no. This is the worst possible news, you know, that I could get. I thought she was going to turn into some sexually repressed prude or something. You know, I was going to be serving the poor in Skid Row all the time or something. I didn't sign up for this stuff. Honestly, the first word that went through my mind, divorce. I'm out of here. I don't need this stuff. But I stuck around. And what really shocked me was in the ensuing months, I began to see positive changes in, you know, her character and her values and the way she related to me and the children. It was winsome. It was attractive. And so finally, one Sunday morning, she said to me, "Lee, why don't you come to church with me today?" And I you know what, I'm going to go. Get around this cult, you know, that she's involved in. So I went to a church. It was meeting in a movie theater about a mile from my house. And the pastor gets up to preach. And he was a young guy. I don't even think he was shaving yet. His name was Bill Hybels. And he gave a talk called Basic Christianity. And I remember sitting there listening to this stuff, and I'm thinking, you know, one by one, my misconceptions about the Christian faith were getting shattered. And I remember walking out that day saying two things. First of all, I was still an atheist. He didn't convince me that day that God exists. But secondly, I realized, you know what? If this stuff is true, this has huge implications for my life. Duh, right? So what I decided to do on that day was take my legal training, take my journalism training, and systematically investigate, is there any credibility to Christianity or any other faith system for that matter? And I launched on what turned out to be a nearly two-year investigation of the evidence. And guess what? It took like a nanosecond for me in the course of this investigation to realize that all of Christianity, in fact, all of world religions, everything on this topic boils down to one question. Just one question. And the question is this. Did Jesus Christ, or did he not, return from the dead? Now, why is that so important? Because Jesus clearly made the claim that he was the Son of God. You can go back to the earliest biography written about Jesus, written by Mark, based on the eyewitness testimony of Peter, who was a firsthand disciple of Jesus. You could look through all the documents and make up the writings in the New Testament, the biographies of Jesus, and you could say that Jesus at least made the claim that he was divine. In fact, at one point, John 10, verse 30, Jesus got up before a group and he said, I and the Father are one. And the word in the Greek there for one means one in essence, one in nature. And how did the audience understand what he was saying? They picked up stones to kill him because they said, you, a mere man, are claiming to be God. So Jesus clearly made the claim that he's divine. But you know what? You could make that claim. I could make that claim. Who cares? But here's the deal. If Jesus made the claim that he's divine, and then he died and later rose from the dead, then that is pretty good evidence that he is telling the truth. That's why the resurrection is the centerpiece of the Christian faith. The Apostle Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 17. He says, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. In other words, this is the ball game. So what I want to do for the next few minutes, I want to summarize for you the evidence I encountered in my investigation about the resurrection of Jesus. And I'm going to summarize this evidence by using four words that begin with the letter E. And I want to do that for those of us who are Christians, that maybe this will give you a framework to think about. You know, Easter's coming up, and as you get into conversations about why you believe what you believe, maybe these four E's could help you remember, kind of organize in your mind what the evidence is for the resurrection. But I know some of you are here because you're not Christians yet. You're spiritually curious, or you're even a skeptic or an atheist. I met last hour a couple atheists who were here. It's fantastic. I'm glad they came. For you, my hope is that God might use these four E's to ambush you like he ambushed me. Now, two caveats real quickly. One is the framework, this 4E framework. I got the idea for this, and I've adjusted it and expanded upon the original. But the original concept for this E thing came from a friend of mine, Dr. Gary Habermas, who's probably the leading authority on the resurrection of Jesus in the world. So I always like to give him credit for the idea. And then secondly, I want to emphasize that when I did this investigation as a skeptic, I did not consider the New Testament of the Bible to be special in any way. I didn't consider it to be the Word of God. I didn't consider it to be inerrant or divinely inspired or anything special. I only considered the New Testament of the Bible to be what it undeniably is, which is a set of ancient historical documents. And I was trained at Yale Law School by some of the greatest experts on evidence in the world. How you can examine documents and study documents and try to discern whether or not they're telling the truth about what they claim took place. I mean, you could do this with Josephus or Tacitus or any other ancient historians. So I just kept the New Testament on that same plane, didn't give it any special credence. Just like any other ancient document, it can be investigated. So what are the four E's that summarize the evidence for the resurrection? The first E stands for the word execution. Execution. That Jesus was dead after being crucified. You got to have a death, right, before you have a resurrection. And I used to think, like some skeptics, that, well, maybe Jesus didn't die on the cross. Maybe he fainted. Or maybe he faked his death, and then the cool, damp air of the tomb brought him around. And so we don't have a miraculous resurrection. We just have a fortuitous resuscitation. That's what I thought. But then, hey, I'm a journalist. I check things out. I interviewed scholars. I interviewed historians. I interviewed archaeologists. I interviewed medical forensic experts. I went to the leading experts in the world on crucifixion and what it's involved. And as I studied this, I realized Jesus was dead after being crucified. That is one of the most non-controversial statements you can make. What actually took place? Well, as you look at the ancient documents, and this is consistent with what we know from other documents based on the first century methods of execution by the Romans, that before Jesus was crucified, he was first flogged by Roman soldiers. I mean, this was an absolutely horrific beating that Jesus endured. He was stripped, he was tied to a post, he was beaten with whips that had jagged bits of sheep bone and balls of lead embedded in them. He was pummeled, beaten to a pulp. How many of you saw the movie The Passion of Christ? Anybody see it? Yeah. You know how bloody it was in that? That doesn't even capture how gruesome this beating was. Let me read to you an eyewitness account of a Roman flogging. Quote, "The sufferer's veins were laid bare, and the very muscles and tendons and bowels of the victim were laid open to exposure." As I interviewed scholars and medical experts, they could look at the clues in the ancient records to see that Jesus was in hypovolemic shock, that is, shock from a great loss of blood after this beating that he endured. He was in serious or critical condition even before he was crucified. And then nails are driven through his wrists. Nails are driven through his feet. He's hoisted on the cross. And I used to wonder, well, what kills you? What's the cause of death in crucifixion? And as I interviewed scholars on this, what I learned is that crucifixion is essentially an agonizingly slow death by asphyxiation, by suffocation. Why? Because when you're hanging on the cross in that position, it puts incredible stresses on your chest muscles, and it locks your lungs into the inhaled position. So the only way you can continue to breathe and stay alive is by somehow releasing that tension on your chest. The only way to do that is to push up with your feet. And of course, you got a spike through your feet. Your bloody back is scraping against the coarse wood of the cross. You have to push up. So then you can release that stress, you can exhale, you can take in a new breath, and then you settle down on the cross until you need to breathe again. Then you push up again, you breathe, and you keep doing that until exhaustion takes over. You can no longer do that. You sag on the cross, and you asphyxiate, you suffocate, and die from the effects of that. In fact, if the Romans wanted to hasten your death, they would take a metal rod, and they would shatter your shin bones. Well, then you couldn't push up anymore. You just sag and die. But we know in Jesus' case, he was already dead. And just to confirm that, they shoved the spear. It went between his ribs. It punctured both his lung and his heart. And he was declared dead by multiple experts. Friends, Jesus was dead when he came down off that cross. In fact, there is no dispute about this among scholars in the field, including atheist scholars, skeptical scholars. This is a non-controversial statement. Why? Because not only do we have multiple early independent accounts of the death of Jesus on the cross in the documents that make up the New Testament, the Bible, we've also got five ancient sources outside the Bible that confirm and corroborate it. We have Josephus, a first century Jewish historian who worked for the Romans. We have Tacitus, another early historian. Even the Jewish Talmud admits that Jesus died when he was crucified. So I say this is not controversial among scholars who study the issue, including skeptics. Let me quote to you from an atheist New Testament scholar, Gerd Ludemann of Vanderbilt University. He said, quote, "Jesus' death as a consequence of crucifixion is indisputable." How many things do ancient historians look back in history and say, it's indisputable? Here you have a skeptical, atheistic scholar conceding that the death of Jesus is a non-controversial issue. The first E stands for execution. Jesus was dead. The second E stands for the word early. We have early reports or early accounts of the resurrection of Jesus. Well, why is that important? Because I used to think, okay, all right, let's say Jesus did die on the cross. Then I thought, well, maybe the idea of the resurrection is a legend. right? Legends develop over time, don't they? So I thought, well, maybe 100, 150, 200 years after the life of Jesus, legends, mythologies began to grow up around his life. And so people would say, oh, yeah, this guy Jesus lived a long time ago. Yeah, he was a really amazing guy. You know, he rose from the dead. No kidding. Oh, yeah. And they kind of made this stuff up. That's what I thought. But what I learned as I interviewed scholars is that the evidence completely decimates the theory that the resurrection of Jesus was a mere legend. Follow me on this. This is so fascinating. We have preserved for us a creed of the earliest church. In other words, the earliest church in the first century used to get together on a Sunday morning. They would recite this creed based on facts that they knew to be true. This creed contains the essence of Christianity. Let me read it to you because the Apostle Paul preserves it for us in 1 Corinthians 15, starting at verse 3. This is what Paul says. For he's talking to the church in Corinth. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. Let's stop there. That is technical rabbinic language. When a rabbi in the first century was going to pass on sacred tradition, this is what they would say. For what I received, I'm not going to change it or mess with it or anything. It's so important, I received it. I'm going to pass it on to you. Well, what does this creed say? What does the sacred tradition say? Well, that Christ died. Why? For our sins, according to the Scriptures. That he was buried. That he was raised on the third day, according to the Scriptures. And that he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Some have died. So in other words, hey, if you don't believe us, the guys are still around who saw this. Go talk to them yourself. Check it out yourself. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, Paul adds, he appeared to me also. Now, here's the thing. I'm not quoting this in the Bible saying, oh, it's in the Bible, so it must be true. No, no. What I'm saying is the important thing about this creed is how early it comes after the death of Jesus. Scholars from a wide range of theological belief have dated this creed as early as 2 to 5 years after the life of Jesus. And therefore, the beliefs that make up that creed go back even earlier, virtually to the cross itself. So the point is, legends take a long time to develop. There was no time for this to develop as a legend. We have a news flash about the resurrection of Jesus that goes back virtually to the cross itself. One of the greatest classical historians who ever lived was A.N. Sherwin White of Oxford University. He actually studied the rate at which legend would grow up in the ancient world. And he determined that the passage of 2 generations of time is not even enough for legend to grow up and wipe out a solid core of historical truth. Well, we don't have 2 generations of time passing here. We got a newsflash that goes right back to the scene. Friends, it would be unprecedented in the history of the world for legend to grow up that fast and wipe out a solid core of historical belief. And that creed is just one of several early reports we have about the resurrection of Jesus. We have others in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and in the book of Acts, in Paul's letters elsewhere, that also date back so early that they cannot merely be manufactured out of whole cloth. In fact, they were circulating during the lifetimes of Jesus' contemporaries, who would have been all too glad to point out the errors if they were just making this stuff up. So the first E is for execution. Jesus was dead. Second E is for early accounts. That this, friends, this rules out the possibility that the resurrection could be a legend. It just came up that fast. The third E stands for the word empty. We have an empty tomb. The historical record says that Jesus' body was laid in a tomb belonging to Joseph of Arimathea, a member of the Jewish council. It was sealed. Matthew reports it was guarded by highly disciplined Roman soldiers, and yet it's discovered empty on that first Easter morning. Now, here's the thing about the empty tomb. I could spend the rest of the day talking about all the different strands of historical evidence that established that the tomb of Jesus was empty, but I'm just going to give you one fact because I think it sums everything up. I think the most powerful fact about the empty tomb is this. There was nobody in the first century who was claiming that it was anything but empty. In other words, even the opponents of Jesus admitted that the tomb of Jesus was empty. How do we know? Because they bribed the guards to make up the story that they had fallen asleep and the disciples had stolen the body while they were sleeping. Now, nobody believed that ridiculous story then. Nobody believes it now. Why? The disciples didn't have the motive or the means or the opportunity. This is a stupid story to come up with. But here's the point. What was it? It was a cover story. Why do you have to make up a cover story? What are you covering up? The fact that the tomb is empty. The mere fact that they came up with a cover story is an implicit admission. We got an empty tomb. We better come up with a story to explain it away. I think that in and of itself, even the opponents of Jesus are conceding it's empty. Friends, the question of history has never been, was the tomb of Jesus empty? The question of history has always been this: how did it get empty? And I went the usual list of suspects. You know, it wasn't going to be the Romans stealing the body. They wanted Jesus dead. Jewish leaders weren't about to steal the body. They wanted Jesus to stay dead. You know, disciples weren't about to steal the body. Why? So they could live a life of deprivation and be tortured to death for what they knew was a lie? I don't think so. Martyrs, or liars make bad martyrs, you know. So I think the most logical explanation for the tomb of Jesus being empty is that he physically rose from the dead, especially when we combine it with the fourth word that begins with the letter E, which is the word eyewitnesses. Not only was Jesus' tomb empty, but over a period of time, Jesus appeared alive to 515 individuals, to skeptics and opponents, as well as to believers, to men and to women, indoors and outdoors, to tender-hearted people and hard-hearted people. People talked with them, they touched him, they ate with him. And think about this, 515 eyewitnesses. One of my jobs as legal editor of the Chicago Tribune was to travel the country and cover major trials. I covered cases where the death penalty was hanging in the balance. I never saw a case with 515 eyewitnesses. I mean, think, you know, if we were to take this chair and turn it into a witness stand, and we were to call to the witness stand every individual who encountered the resurrected Jesus, and we were to question them and cross-examine them, just 15 minutes each, and we were to sit here around the clock, do you realize we'd be sitting here for 5 straight days? How many among us, after having heard 128 straight hours of eyewitness testimony, would walk away saying, "Nah, I don't believe it"? And this is an incredible amount of evidence. As far as the disciples are concerned, in all we have 9 ancient sources that reflect multiple, very early, and eyewitness-based reports of their encounter with the risen Jesus. Friends, the evidence for this is so strong. Let me read to you an admission by the atheist, again, the atheist historian and New Testament scholar, Gerd Ludemann. He concedes this, quote, "It may be taken as historically certain that Peter and the disciples had experiences after Jesus' death in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ." The evidence forced him to make that admission. Now, he's an atheist. Got to find a loophole here, right? There's got to be a loophole, right? And his loophole was, well, wait a minute. Maybe these were just visions. Maybe Jesus wasn't resurrected. They're just seeing visions. And that's what I thought, too. That was my loophole when I was an atheist. Oh, wait a minute. What if these are just hallucinations? That would explain this away, wouldn't it? They're just having hallucinations. I thought that, well, there you go. Case closed. But, hey, I'm a reporter. I check things out. So I track down a scholar who's an expert on hallucinations. He has a PhD in psychology. He was a professor of psychology for 20 years at a major Midwestern university. He's written like 32 books on psychology, and he was the president of a National Association of Psychologists and Counselors. I figure this guy's got great credentials. So I laid out all the evidence. I said, "Now, Dr. Collins, will you not admit to me that what these disciples saw was not the resurrected Jesus, it was merely hallucinations?" And he looked at me and he said, "Lee, that is not possible." I said, "Well, you seem pretty sure of yourself." He said, "Well, I am an expert on hallucinations." I said, "Well, you got to explain this. Why are you so sure of yourself?" He said, "Lee, you got to understand how hallucinations work. They are individual occurrences that happen in your mind. They're like dreams. They don't spread like the common cold. I can't say to you, how'd you like that dream I had last night? Doesn't work. You can't wake up your spouse in the middle of the night and say, honey, honey, wake up, wake up. I'm having a great dream about a vacation in Maui. Let's both go back to sleep. We'll have the same dream. We'll save all the airfare. We'll save all the hotel costs. This will be great. Don't you wish we could do that? But we can't. Why? Because dreams are individual occurrences that happen in our own heads. And hallucinations are the same thing. In fact, then Dr. Collins says something I will never forget. He said, Lee, 515 people having the same hallucination at the same time would be a bigger miracle than the resurrection itself. And then he added this. He said, and by the way, if these were just hallucinations, then I'm assuming the body is still in the tomb, right? Oops, the body's gone. Well, I didn't give up. I thought, okay, doc, you're the expert. I'll grant you these couldn't be hallucinations, but maybe it's something more subtle than that. There is a phenomenon that is recognized in the psychological literature called groupthink. And groupthink means there's a group of people, and they want something to happen so bad, they're expecting it to happen. They're living in expectation, and they have such a great desire for it to happen, they begin to see things that aren't there. And so maybe Peter says, he wants Jesus to come back. Oh, I think I see him over in the shadows. John, do you see him over there? And John says, yeah, I think I do. I think I do. And they sort of talk each other into it. That could be, right? And I asked Dr. Collins, he said, no. He said, that doesn't work either. I said, why not? He said, well, first of all, these guys weren't, you have to be primed for a vision like that. You have to be living in strong expectation that you're going to experience something like that. They weren't. These Jewish people in the first century, their belief was there was one resurrection and it came at the end of time. There was no room in their worldview for anybody's going to come back before then. Besides which, some of these people who encountered the resurrected Jesus were skeptics. They weren't living in anticipation and hoping for Jesus' return. Think of Saul of Tarsus. He was an enemy of Christians. He was killing Christians because he hated them. He encountered the resurrected Jesus. And he became the Apostle Paul, the greatest missionary of all time. He wasn't living in anticipation of seeing a vision. What about James, a half-brother of Jesus? We have excellent historical data that James was not a believer in his half-brother Jesus' divinity during Jesus' lifetime. We also have excellent historical data that he later died proclaiming Jesus is the Son of God, who proved it by returning from the dead. What happened to change him? 1 Corinthians 15, the resurrected Jesus appeared to him. Couldn't have been a vision because he didn't believe in him. He wasn't anticipating his brother coming back from the dead. He didn't have, it wasn't wish fulfillment for him. So he said, yeah, this isn't groupthink. This isn't a vision. This isn't a hallucination. And it's not mythology, and it's not legend, and it's not wishful thinking. I mean, think of the disciples. After the crucifixion of Jesus, they're what? They're dejected. They're despondent. They're depressed. Their leader is gone forever. They're afraid they're going to get crucified. They're freaking out. They're going to go into hiding. They're being cowards. And yet history undeniably shows that these same individuals, a few weeks later, in the very same city where Jesus had been put to death, are now suddenly proclaiming with boldness and courage that Jesus is the Son of God, who proved it by returning from the dead. And they were willing to proclaim that to their deaths. And here's the key to that. They were willing to die for their conviction Jesus rose from the dead, not just because they had faith in it, like some terrorist would die today for his faith. No. They weren't willing to die for it because they just believed it was true or somebody told them it was true. No. In all of history, the disciples were in a unique position. They were there. They knew the truth. They encountered Jesus, they touched him, they talked with him, they ate with him. And knowing the truth that he was resurrected from the dead, they were willing to die for it. That is strong corroborative evidence that what they were saying is what actually took place. Friends, I spent 2 years of my life investigating this stuff until finally, it was a Sunday afternoon. And I thought, I got this mountain of evidence. I got to begin sifting this. I got to reach a verdict somehow. And so I remember I went alone in my room, and I took a yellow legal pad. And I thought, I'm just going to summarize the evidence I've encountered. So I start writing, page after page after page after page after page. And finally, I put down my pen, and I said, wait a minute. In light of the avalanche of evidence that points so powerfully toward the truth of Christianity, I realized it would take more faith to maintain my atheism than to become a Christian. Seriously, honestly, I mean that. I mean, what I mean by that, I guess, is if you were to picture a river with a strong current flowing in a direction, that would represent the evidence flowing toward a conclusion that Jesus rose from the dead. To maintain my atheism at that point, knowing that evidence, I would have to swim upstream against all of this evidence flowing the other direction. I couldn't do that. I was trained in journalism and law to respond to truth. And so at that moment, I realized this is true based on the historical data. And I said, I now believe it. And then I stopped and I said, am I done? Is that it? Can I stop now? I didn't know what to do. I was stuck. And then I remembered a Christian friend of mine earlier had pointed out a verse to me. So I got out the Bible. I looked it up. John 1:12 said, but as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believed in his name. And I noticed something about that verse. If you were to extract the active verbs from that verse, it forms an equation of what it means to become a child of God. Believe plus receive equals become. And I thought, okay, I do believe based on the historical data that Jesus rose from the dead and thus proved he's the Son of God. But I realized that's not enough. I had to receive Jesus as my forgiver and leader. I had to receive this free gift of his grace, this gift of forgiveness and eternal life that he purchased on the cross when he died as my substitute to pay for all of my wrongdoing, past, present, and future. And when I received this free gift, I didn't deserve, I didn't earn this free gift of his grace, then I would become a child of God. And so I got on my knees next to my bed, and I poured out a confession of a lifetime of immorality that would make your hair curl. And at that moment, I received complete and total forgiveness from Jesus Christ, and I became a child of God forever. And my very next thought was, hey, I should tell Leslie about this. You know, maybe my wife be interested in knowing, you know, I didn't know. So, honestly, I don't know how she'd react, but I should tell her. So I remember right after I did that, I thought, okay, I walked down the hallway to find her, and I looked into the kitchen, and there she was, standing behind the kitchen sink. And standing in front of her, remember I told you my little daughter, Allison? She was almost 5 years old by then. She was standing in front of Leslie, and Allison was standing on her tippy toes and reaching out, and for the first time, she was able to touch the faucet. So I walked down the hallway. I looked in the kitchen. Allison saw me. He said, Daddy, Daddy, look, look. I can touch it. I can reach it. I said, wow, you're really getting big. And she ran off. And I turned to Leslie. I said, honey, that's how I feel. I said, I feel like for the last 2 years of my life, I've been reaching out and reaching out and reaching out. I just touched Jesus. He's alive. He's resurrected. He's real. He's the Son of God. I just gave him my life. And she looked at me, and I burst into tears. And she threw her arms around my neck, and she said, you hard-hearted son of a Baptist, I've been telling you this for 2 years. No, I'm kidding. She just that would have been funny, but she didn't do that. She threw her arms around me, and she's crying. And she said, oh, honey, I've given up on you so many times. She said, when I was a new Christian, I met some women at church. And I told them, I don't have any hope for my husband. He is the hard-headed, hard-hearted legal editor of the Chicago Tribune. He will never bend his knee to Jesus Christ. And she said, this one sweet elderly woman put her arm around her shoulder, and she pulled her aside. And she said, oh, Leslie, no one is beyond hope. And she gave her a verse from the Old Testament, Ezekiel 36:26, that says, moreover, I will give you a new heart and I will put a new spirit within you. I will remove from you your heart of stone, it says, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And unbeknownst to me, my wife, behind the scenes, the entire 2 years of my investigation, she was praying that verse for me. And can I tell you what happened? Starting on that Sunday afternoon, not overnight, but over time, as I opened my life to Jesus Christ, as I began to walk his path instead of my path, God began to answer that prayer because my character changed and my values changed and my morality changed and my worldview changed and my philosophy changed and my attitudes changed and my relationships changed and my priorities changed and my marriage changed, my parenting, all these things over time began to change for the good. I used to get to this point where I would tell people my story, and this is where I get stuck. Because you didn't know me. You didn't know me before I was Christian. How can you possibly understand the difference God has made in my life? There's no way for you, because you didn't know me. And I struggle. How do I communicate? How do I let you know the depth of the change that God has brought into my life? And the only thing I've ever been able to come up with that, you know, communicates that is what happened to my daughter, Allison. I mean, think about this. Here was a little girl who the first 5 years of her life just knew a dad who was absent or angry or getting drunk or kicking holes in the wall. That was her whole experience. But she began to watch. You know, with her little five-year-old eyes, she began to watch as her daddy began to change in front of her eyes. She never interviewed a scholar, never studied ancient history, never studied archaeology. All she did is watch and listen and listen and watch for like 4 or 5 months. And then one Sunday, she went first to her Sunday school teacher and then to my wife, and you know what she said? I want God to do for me what he's done for daddy. And at age 5, my little girl became a follower of Jesus Christ. And today, she's 34 years old. She writes Christian novels. She's married to a seminary graduate. She's the mother of my 2 precious granddaughters. And she is my very, very best friend. And my son, too, same thing. He watched as God changed his family in front of his eyes, and he learned and so forth. He came to faith at a young age. He went off. He got an undergraduate degree in biblical studies. Then he went off and got a master's degree in philosophy of religion. He got another master's degree in New Testament. Now he's getting his PhD in theology at the University of Aberdeen in Scotland. Because he said, Dad, there's a whole generation out there, my generation, that doesn't get it yet. They don't understand. This isn't mythology. This isn't make-believe, legend, wishful thinking. This is built on a solid foundation of historical truth. And I said, son, you study, you get your PhD, you go tell your generation. Friends, God changed my life. He changed my wife. He changed my son. And he changed my daughter. And that's my story. So what do you do with it? What do you do with it? Let me just end. Just for a couple minutes here. Let me just end by applying my story to you. I want to go back to that equation. Believe plus receive equals become. And just start there and say, you know what? Some of you don't yet believe. You know, a friend brought you here today. You came. God bless you. I'm glad you did. Maybe you've heard some things that are challenging or interesting, but you're not there yet. Can I tell you something? That's okay. That is okay as long as you do what I did and you check it out yourself. The New Testament and the Old Testament both say, if you sincerely seek God, you will find him. So make it a front burner issue in your life. Check it out. If I can help you, I'd love to do that. I've written a new book called The Case for the Real Jesus. I traveled 24,000 miles to sit down with scholars and experts and attack them with the toughest objections to Christianity that you're reading about in these books by atheists and atheist documentaries and all these things, to see, are there good answers that we can understand in defense of Christianity? And I've put that in this book, The Case for the Real Jesus. So if that could be a resource for you, or maybe you have a friend or a son or a daughter, who you know, might be helpful to kind of help them in their journey. We've got some afterwards. Be glad to talk to you about it or sign a copy, whatever. But I'll give you something totally free. We created a website for you. And on this website, we have loaded hundreds of free video clips from scholars and experts talking about not just what Christians believe, but why we believe it. So you can go in there, type in your question. What about this? What about that? What about the reliability of the Gospels? What about Islam? Whatever. Boom! Up will come all these free video clips, and you can spend as much time as you want. Won't cost you a dime. It's LeeStrobel.com, and it's there for you. But if you don't yet believe, check it out. You owe it to yourself. But I want to end with this. Friends, some of you might believe, but you've never received. You believe the right stuff. You believe God exists. You believe Jesus is his son. You believe he died in the cross. You believe all that. You believe he rose from the dead. But why is it God seems so distant to you? Why is it when we sing this song earlier about being a friend of God, you say, I don't feel like I have a relationship with him. He seems so distant. Could it be? I'm just raising a question. Could it be you believe the right stuff, but there's never been a point in time where you have received Jesus as your forgiver and leader and thus become a child of God according to John 1:12? I'm just asking. You don't have to have every answer to every question. You don't have to know everything to know something. You know what you can know with confidence? Jesus claimed to be the Son of God, and he backed it up by returning from the dead. Friends, that is enough for now. If you believe as best you can, and you want to receive, I don't want to let another moment to go by. I want to give you a chance to do that right now. And I'm not going to embarrass you or do anything like that. Let's just close our eyes. And if you want to take that step, if you want to receive it, you know, I thought about this last hour. I should have brought my daughter. I should have had my daughter stand on the stage and look you in the eye and say, what part of this offer from the God of the universe don't you want? Complete and total forgiveness of all of your sins, the door of heaven being flung open for eternity. What part of this don't you want, not just for you, but the influence you're going to have down the generations in your family? I should have brought my, next time I'm bringing my daughter. But if you want to receive, then in your heart, you don't have to say anything out loud. God will hear you in your heart. Just in your heart say, Lord Jesus, I know I have fallen short of how you want me to live. I know that. I've done things I knew they were wrong before I did them, and I did them anyway. I haven't lived up to my own standards of morality, much less yours, which are infinitely higher. And so I confess, Lord Jesus, that I'm a sinner. And right now, I want to turn from my life the way I've been living it. I want to walk your path with your help. Lord Jesus, I reach out right now in repentance and faith, and I receive this free gift of forgiveness and eternal life that you purchased by your death on the cross when you died for all of my wrongdoing, past, present, and future. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for being willing to go through that torture of the cross, to die for my sins, that I might be forgiven and spend eternity with you in heaven. Lord Jesus, help me to live the kind of life that you want me to live. Because from this moment on, I am yours. And now, Father, for those that have taken that step today, we celebrate with them. We know what a great adventure awaits them of living this incredible Christian life. So we thank you for that. Father, I pray for those that aren't there yet, that still have doubts, too many questions. They don't yet believe. Father, I pray by your Spirit, you would use books, the website, you'd use this church, whatever you would choose to use to open their eyes to the reality of who you are, that someday we might celebrate their rebirth as well. And Father, for those of us who have been your children for a long time, I pray you would use us, especially as this Easter season is coming up, to share your love and grace and forgiveness and hope to our family and friends and neighbors and those we encounter. Father, thanks for this church that is like a beacon of light that shines your love all over this vicinity. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, who is our forgiver and who is our leader and who is our very, very best friend. Amen.